Welcome back, everyone, to the final session today in Robert Creeley's Library Symposium. The final session is a panel of four graduate students who have been working cataloging this collection and also the Edward Dorn collection that we have at Notre Dame Library. I'd like to introduce all four of the students right now and then let them go in our agreed upon order. So first will be Emma Vanhoozer. Emma's passion is poetry and poetics, the theory, the practice, and the relation between the two. As an undergraduate, she attended Wheaton College in Illinois, where she studied English and theology. At Wake Forest in North Carolina, she wrote her MA thesis on negative theology and apophatic language in T.S. Eliot's The Wasteland and Four Quartets. At Notre Dame, she discovered the Black Mountain poets thanks to her work in the Robert Creeley and Ed Dorn archives. She's currently studying the continuities and or discontinuities between modernist and postmodernist poetics in transatlantic poetry. The second student to read is Douglas Duhaime to speak. Doug is a doctoral student in English at Notre Dame who's conducted archival research on Black Mountain poets in the North Carolina State Archives and the University of Connecticut at Storrs. His current research interests focus on computer-assisted text analysis and the interrelationships between natural philosophy and political identity in 18th century British literature. Later this year, 18th century fiction will publish his study on medical politics in the works of Tobias Smollett, and Swift Studies will publish his study on Swift's relationship to Isaac Newton. Aleksandra Hernandez, who has a BA from the University of Toronto and an MA from there as well, joined the PhD program here in the fall of 2012, where she studies 19th century American transcendentalism. She's interested in thinking about the relationship or the representation of fictional minds in textual spaces and has become fascinated by animal and non-human phenomenologies. She envisions a dissertation that incorporates interests in cognitive poetics, narrative ethics, and eco-criticism. Fourth student is Joel Duncan, who's a PhD candidate in English, working on the development of capitalism and personal experience in American poetry, both in the mid-19th and the mid-20th centuries. He arranged and wrote the finding aids for the ephemera from Robert Creeley's library, such as the typewriter that's out on display in the exhibition, as well as the manuscript collection of his letters to his sister, to his daughter, Sarah Creeley.
When Steve Friedman first invited me to work on the Creeley archives, I was excited about the opportunity, but the truth was I had never read a word of Creeley before. I rushed to the library. The first poem I read was intriguing to me, but ultimately inscrutable. I went from that moment, curiosity but final bewilderment, to a moment almost precisely a year later. I was walking through a deserted parking lot in the middle of a thunderstorm at night, and the words of this poem came back to me. I was, as the beat poets say, got by the poem. So what I thought I'd do is frame my presentation around the way that my reading of this poem changed over the course of a year, thanks to various experiences in the archive, because I think I'm in the unique position of coming to know Creeley first in his archives and through the materials that I read, and only afterwards through reading his poetry. I'd like to start by reading the poem, just so we have the language out, and so I have it in my mouth, and then I'll return to it at the end. The poem is called A Prayer. Bless something small, but infinite and quiet. There are senses make an object in their simple feeling for one. And again, at the end, I'll ask whether there's something structurally analogous between the way that the archive is working and the way the poem is working that facilitated my gradual understanding of Creeley's poetry. But to begin with, the library. Our actual task was, as you know, to archive the books in Creeley's library. We have over 5,000 of the books, but I think we must have received what Steve Clay referred to as the inner circle, the 1,200. I definitely didn't touch 5,000 of the books. And our task was to separate the books that had some material by Creeley from the books that didn't. What we quickly discovered is over two-thirds of the books had something by Creeley. So we had to divide a system of triage, separating books with nothing, separating books with just some annotations, and then books that really had a lot of inserts in them. As far as the findings, there were three sorts of materials that we were looking for. First thing was any marginalia, date, name, place, or some annotations. As Penelope Creeley noticed, there weren't a lot of annotations that we actually found or that I remember finding in the poetry itself. There were some lines in novels next to particular places, but I was interested in that, and I would like to understand his sort of system of marginalia better. Then we found inserts. These included, all sorts of objects. One of my favorites was a secondhand book by Wordsworth, where we found a flower that had been pressed and put inside. This is especially appropriate for a Wordsworth collection, right? There were also tickets, plane tickets, ticket stubs from concerts, museums, shows, invitations, presumably everything that he had been at while reading the book. This resonated, again, with what we heard earlier in the morning, that the book sprang organically from his life and that we can sort of trace where he was at certain periods or what he was doing, what he was experiencing from what he placed in the books. We also found, obviously, personal correspondences, postcards, letters, business cards, photographs, poems. One of my favorite was a book by Charles Bernstein, a poet, that was sent to him called Resistances. And in the book, there was a poem. There was a printout of a poem, presumably by Charles Bernstein. And Creeley had gone through and corrected parts of it, particularly prepositions. And he did a few of this in other poems. Wasn't sure if he was planning to send it back or if this was for his own satisfaction, but it's fun to see his choice. And then finally, inscriptions. Most of the books, or I think a third of the books that we received were books that were sent to him by poets. And this was striking to me, that this was this comprised his library books that people wanted him to read. I was also surprised by the range of people that sent him books. There was obviously the inner circle, Black Mountain poets, Beat poets, but then also folks that I wouldn't have expected as much. Novelists, Paul Auster, it was interesting to me, Wendell Berry. And then most of the inscriptions were thank you notes. I have one of my favorites by Adrienne Rich here, which is, again, interesting because a poet might not have been influenced by him. She writes, "For Bob Creeley, to whom I've been listening all these years, unseen, with affection from Adrienne." I have a printout, actually, of many of the other notes that we found, so if people have folks after this about people who wrote to Creeley, I can refer more specifically to that. Another striking feature of the inscriptions was how many of them were written in a style or language that was very similar to a Beat poetics. So I have a couple others up here, some examples. Stan Brackage writes, "What to say? This and blessing, plus Stan Brackage, and thanks, Stan." And then Ted Berrigan, "For Penelope plus for Bob, with love and Buffalo, 8 May 21, you're a beating cert." This disregard for grammatical conventions or playing around with grammatical conventions and use of abbreviations is, again, typical of the Black Mountain poetics. So it's interesting that the people that are writing to him are themselves informed by his poetry. So this is how I first learned Creeley in this network of relationships that was his library. And with this in mind, I wanted to return to my initial question, how did my work in the archives inform my reading of Creeley's poetry? So it seems to me this is one of the payoffs of having it here in our library and during my graduate degree. In one of his essays, Creeley suggests a connection himself implicitly. The essay is called I'm Given to Writing Poems, and I'll read two short passages from it. This one will resonate with what we learned earlier about his experiences from the library. He writes, "Coming from New England, I felt awkwardness about books to begin with, because they were for me often instances of social mark or measure, even at times a privilege of intellectual order. I was very shy about communicating my own commitments in reading, and yet I used books as a very real place to be. Not merely an escape from the world, the difficulty was how to get into it, not away. Books proved a place very deeply open to me, at moments of reading, in a sense few others were ever to be." So Creeley's reflection on how he used books in his early life, or the sense of what books were to him, I think can be applied fairly clearly to the library and the way that the library functions. The books are literal placeholders for kept objects, correspondences, parts of relationships that we had with people, and places that he had been when he was reading the certain books. What's especially interesting to me is that later in the essay, he describes poetry in exactly the same language. So I thought I would read this other quote. "The sense of a poem, that place, that meadow, has echoes of so many things that are intimate to my own sense of the reality experienced in writing. It is to experience oneself as in the world, thus, through this agency of fact we call, variously, poetry." The concept of place, then, is distinctive to Creeley's poetics, and we see it both in his archive, I think, and in his poetry. an individual book in Creeley's library as much as the archives as a whole, for work as a very real place to be, the way a poem works as a place to be. It's a location that one can find oneself in by passing into a network of relationships. By way of conclusion, then, I'd like to return to the poem I started with and to point to two ways in which I've come to understand that the poetry works structurally analogously to the way that the library works. So I'll pull it up as I talk about it. First of all, we can see that the poem works by creating different relationships, by the sets of relationships it creates. So I'll just point to two examples. The way that we read the first word, bless, it can be read as an imperative, you must bless something that is small, or also as an infinitive, to bless is to do something small. These different readings depend on different ways of relating the first line to the next three lines. You can do the same for the last line. Quiet could also be an adjective, bless something small and quiet, or an imperative, bless and be quiet. This way of, I think we could go through every single line of the poem and see how we can relate them differently to create different sorts of meanings, as well as to the two stanzas themselves. So this is one thing that seems to me analogous in the way that the poetry is working to the way that the library works itself. The second more interesting thing to me is the personal element to this. The person is the one who is not in the poem. That we have one personal pronoun at the very end, one, that could refer to an object, or it could be an impersonal pronoun. But that means that the reader is the one that has to make all these relationships. And this is, again, very much like my experience in the archives. As I went down there, I realized that this is a place where a person makes systems of relationships, realizes systems of relationships through the people that are writing, sending books to Creeley. In retrospect, then, I think I can see how my experience in the archives has contributed to my sense of Creeley's poetry, of how to read the poetry, and to see both the archives and the poetry as instances of what it meant for Creeley to be placed, and then also as occasions for us to be placed as readers or archivists. I wonder then if the Creeley archives, the books, the correspondences, the ticket stubs, can be senses make an object in their simple feeling for one. Thank you.
In my talk, I wanted to sort of build on Emma's discussion and begin answering the question, what will the Creeley archive at Notre Dame mean for future scholars? And so in order to pursue that question, I wanted to talk about just a few of the highlights in the archive and some of the work that I think the archive could be put to use in future work. So to begin, Creeley's books and the question of influence. I think just the sheer fact of Creeley's texts, all of the books in his library, now that they've been curated, now that we have a complete list of those texts, I think that can open up interesting opportunities for influence studies, for the analysis of Creeley's sources in his poetry, in his letters, in his prose, in his poetics. You know, what are some of the sources for these writings? More interesting, perhaps, is Creeley's correspondence. There's really a tremendous variety of materials stuffed into Creeley's books that really are filing cabinets of sorts, as Professor Fredman had suggested. To take just one example here, this is a letter written by Allen Ginsberg. It's a little difficult to see in the photograph. Creeley had this letter stuffed in his copy of Howell, and perhaps this letter could help to allow us to better understand how Creeley read Howell. So in the letter, Ginsberg is writing to Mr. David Kennedy, Secretary of Treasury in D.C., and he says, Dear Mr. Kennedy, this is a response to your department's notice of 11 July 1969 concerning tax assessment against me, gives a social security number, of $1,486 plus interest for the year 1968. He says, I am not able to pay this money into our treasury to be expended in the continuing illegal and immoral effort to kill or subdue more Vietnamese people. And he goes on and he basically refuses to pay his taxes as a protest against the war. And he says he's retained an attorney and he welcomes a discussion between Mr. Kennedy and his attorney. And so this is just one of the letters, you know, one of the really sort of rich letters in an interesting position in the Creeley texts. Much more work, I think, could be done with Creeley's reading. So a few of the speakers so far have suggested that Creeley didn't annotate his books very much, and that's certainly the case. What he was prone to do, though, was to create these really elaborate lists of reading notes, and I think these are going to be a source of important work in the future. So here is Creeley's annotated index to the cantos of Ezra Pound, and it's multiple pages long, very detailed, very scholarly. In just the first page here, he's talking about Roman political history and the ways that Roman political history finds its way into Pound's cantos. He's talking about the mythological inheritance and literary sources. He's quoting Ovid in this first page, Aeschylus. So very much these kinds of texts very much exhibit Creeley's scholarly mode of reading. To take another example, here's the first page of Creeley's reading notes from Zukofsky's A, another sort of robust collection of thoughts written by Creeley on Zukofsky's poetry. Here he's discussing Zukofsky's notion of breath, his sense of the line, and his relationship to history. I think moving through these reading notes, future work could certainly address Creeley's relationship to Zukofsky and Pound, etc. I think it's also important that in some cases Creeley has stuffed poetic texts into works of poetry, and I think that there could be a relationship there. For instance, in Creeley's or in Ginsberg's Howl, Creeley's copy of Ginsberg's Howl, he has a copy of a short snippet on poetics that Allen Ginsberg had put together, and on this page here, Ginsberg is quoting different strains of poetics from Creeley, Rexroth, Olson, Corso, Williams, many of the sort of leading lights of American modernism. And it does seem significant to me, at least, that this text is inside Ginsberg's Howl. Perhaps this text helped to inform Creeley's reading of Ginsberg. And then there's, I think, a tremendous amount of work to be done on Creeley's networks, just his social networks. We were discussing this a little earlier. Lots and lots of material from other poets, a vast range of American poets and non-American poets, found its way into Creeley's library. And I wanted to close with just a quick example. Here's a poem, very short poem, written by David Rattray, entitled 11 Bantam Eggs for Robert Creeley, written in 1997. In numbers even sang St. Stephen, but number odd rejoiceth God. That's all I had. Thank you.
Might as well just say right now that I did not work on the Creeley archive directly. I worked with Emma this summer cataloging Edward Dorn's collection of a manuscript collection, as well as correspondence and letters. So this is what I'll be sharing with you, and as well a few sort of interesting thought processes that I thought were interesting as you were talking about the Creeley archive that I think echo some of what we found in the Ed Dorn collection. But I'll begin with Robert Creeley, because Robert Creeley had a long-lasting impact on me as well, and I have to thank Emma for this, because we had a class that we were taking with Steve Fredman and Kate Marshall, which was marrying modern American poetry and media theory, a really fascinating course, and Emma gave a lovely sort of seminar presentation introducing the art books, Robert Creeley's art books, to us, and that's just been amazing. For those of you who are poets, you really should look at them, their size and their objectness. You know, they're sort of, I think I was mentioning over lunch that they're kind of like, they almost pop out books just because of the sheer size. So that is really potentially productive too. And I wondered whether he was inspired by Jonathan Swift, but anyway. So I was asked to speak to you today about Ed Dorn's relationship, his archive's relationship with Robert Creeley's. And I think, needless to say, Edward Dorn went to Black Mountain College, and in 1955, Robert Creeley, of course, was his examiner, and there he met Charles Olson and a lot of these other amazing poets that we've been talking about throughout the day. But from what I've known and what I've heard of about the Creeley Archive, Dorn's is very different because it's essentially a manuscript collection. So what was it like? I would say it was overwhelming. And I'm looking right at you, Laura, because sometimes we just didn't know what to do with all the stuff we found. It's a massive collection of letters, manuscripts, notebooks, issues of Rolling Stock, which he and Jenny Dorn published out of in Boulder, Colorado in the 1980s. Just to give you a sense of sort of the vastness of the material we found there, it took us about, would you say it was about a month to get through maybe a third of the letters? And then we really had to speed up because it was just so much of it and had a limited amount of time to work with. We also, what was interesting, these letters itself, calling for someone to go in there and do some work with them. They're full of newspaper clippings, postcards made by artists, originals, candy wrappers. We found a dart practice sheet, desk planners, a lot of different stuff. Did you remember anything else?
Candy wrappers were the one that stood out.
And comic strips. So this was all part of, I think, that creative process and very much part of that network, so that poets, his students would send him newspaper clippings, other poets would as well, artists from around the world. I just found fascinating. I was also quite delighted, I think, with some of the letters. Maybe not by famous people per se, but or at least not in the not to the extent that someone like Robert Duncan is. But I was really fond of some letters, a couple of letters from Christopher Wall Romana, who's a translator. For those of you who translate, there were just some amazing meditations about what it is to translate, and how incredibly difficult it is to translate the feeling of a poem. So there was a lot of really interesting, deep conversation happening between them, between two people who had never physically met. Two letters I found there. I also found some really funny letters. I think he was he a student of Dorn's, Jason Horowitz? I think he was. And just hilarious advertisements, some vulgar, some really funny, political. And of course, there were letters from Robert Creeley, which are displayed out there, and Gary Snyder as well. There were a couple of printed emails, and these were mostly during the time that Ed Dorn was diagnosed with pancreatic cancer. There were original manuscripts, as well as some correspondence with Leroy Jones, whom we've talked about earlier today. And perhaps out of the correspondence, some of the most moving correspondence was with his best friend from high school, Gordon Taylor. Some of the most sort of heartbreaking letters were written to Gordon Taylor involving his relationship with Helena. And I don't want to give too much away, because this is really work for the scholar, the Dorn scholar, who's gonna go in there, but deep meditations about what love is and how messy relationships can sometimes be. And the other wonderful thing was the impression that we got from this network of people to which the Dorns were connected, the sense that they were an unusually strong couple, just a really solid relationship. Everybody always remarks about how lovely they are and what a great couple they are. And people seem to have used them as an example an instance when a relationship isn't broken or full of heartbreak. And we, Emma and I, just found ourselves constantly just wondering how could this be? But But it was just, they seemed like a really solid couple, so that was nice for once. and also, we found original artwork in connection with Rolling Stock by various artists, even a prospectus for the book Under the Fortune Palms by Tom Clark and from Tom Clark, whom Edward Dorn also corresponded with at great length. So we have lots of letters back and forth between these two friends and fellow poets. And the manuscripts were very interesting as well. And there is where I would say that where I really got a sense of Dorn's method to his writing. I would describe it as chaotic, but that's not it. So in searching for the right way to describe what his writing method was, I came up with Protean. Just very organic, a Protean attitude toward language, which I think is related to the way Creeley treats words. His notebooks are full of collages, newspaper clippings, and it's almost like it's written in code, really hard to decipher, but then that's not the point when you go through them. Really, what you get a sense of then are disconnected thoughts and fragments and just piles and piles of words and clippings over piles and piles of words and clippings. And we looked through several of these notebooks, which were artworks in their own right, I would say. This is pretty much it, I think. I mean, to conclude, I think that was the end of our archival experience, I would say. I know that there were a lot of floppy disks as well, which I don't know if we have the technology to decode those, but we didn't get a chance to look through them.
But we're
okay, good. But we did file them. We didn't get through them. So the last thing we saw were the notebooks, and there I would say. Creeley's words, or Creeley's description of Ed Dorn as a poet, really resonated. I hope to God, you know, you are a great poet, and always were and will be. Whatever that wistful word means, you define it. I still see you atop the water tower in Mattoon after graduation, as you said, the highest point to look out from. That high point is sort of like Stephen's man on the dump, right? On this pile and pile of stuff, which is how I would characterize the archive. Thank you.
So I just wanted to give a brief overview of the scope and contents of the ephemera collection, and do a show and tell of some of my favorite items, and then finish by sharing an unpublished an unknown poem by Creeley that I found in one of his books. So there's an ephemera collection which is separate from his, I guess it's 6,000 books and everything that they contained. And it's separate in large part because it was purchased separately and includes broadsides, posters, photographs, magazines and journals, as well as texts, many sent to him by other poets. Items in the exhibition such as the photograph by Allen Ginsberg as well as the Ian Hamilton Finley prints are from this ephemera collection. There are in total 239 items, but some of those items are several items in themselves, for example, collections of photographs. So aside from some of the items that are on display, and I should note there are also more photographs by Ginsberg as well as Elsa Dorfman, which are really great. The items that I found most intriguing in the collection are two letters from the British modernist Basil Bunting, both from 1965. Creeley had toured Europe in 64, and Bunting's best-known poem, Brick Flats, was published in 66, which he discusses in the letters. So Bunting begins his letter of June 29th, 1965. Dear Bob, what a jump of pleasure your name on the envelope gave me. You can't imagine how much people here liked you. Poets of all sorts have taken to coming to Wylam. Some alarming, and my family always contrasts them with you. And then in the middle of the long third paragraph, Bunting writes, Brick Flats has acted like some magic potion out of a legend. It has brought my boyhood suddenly back to life in my old age. The mixture is explosive, and the fuse now burning a short one. I have no idea where the explosion, inevitable, will land me, heaven or hell or back where I am now. And Bunting ends, here I preach Creeley when I can, but I find it isn't needed. Everybody knows and likes your work. The migratory readers Tom Picard has brought to Newcastle have included Allen Ginsberg, whom I liked enormously as a man, and whose poems, though too improvised and slack to be durable, contain so much real cogent stuff. He left me his muffler as a keepsake, and I wore it till I left it at Brig Flats, my flag on the reconquered territory, my pledge to the people who love the place, left as something much valued. So Bunting provides in this letter a striking testament to transatlantic crossings and affinities between these poets, and one would be hard-pressed to find a more succinct and lucid assessment of at least Ginsberg's later work. The second letter is from July 11th. In it, Bunting complains of televisionaries and feature writers who are convinced on no evidence that I am the coming thing. After discussing publication and financial woes, Bunting ends with, let's see, make sure I have that right. I'd like to write to you in a more personal way and say some of the things that are in my mind. But Lord knows when I'll get time. Crises that are real, as well as these silly crises of superficial business, are going on. My past has overflowed into my present because of the poem Brig Flats, and I have no idea what will happen. So much that is sad and comic and piercing. Words are dangerous to handle, worse than TNT. Yet I wait for the explosion with something more like exultation than terror. And I would want to say something about your own delicate, elegant poems and how they lead you along a tightrope and one's heart is in one's mouth for fear you fall off, but you never do. You made a big impression in Newcastle. As with Ginsberg, Bunting captures the ethos of Creeley's verse in a sentence. In both his letters, Bunting writes of the explosion he is experiencing through Brig Flats, which, as he describes in his first letter, seems to have sedimented him to his home. Quote, the world I live in has become quite different and I am lost in it. I keep my head and look for bearings to steer by. I don't find them. But one thing is nearly certain. I, or what's left of me, will be more firmly riveted than ever to Northumberland. I can't help but wonder, after listening to Emma talk about place, at least in terms of the library, if there's some correspondence going on in Bunting's mind between place, Northumberland, and the fact that he's telling Creeley this, if place is also significant for Creeley in a comparable sense. So aside from the ephemera collection with Bunting's letters, there's a separate manuscript collection of Creeley's letters, mostly from the 1990s, acquired from Sarah H. Creeley, one of Robert's daughters with Bobby Louise Hawkins. There are 34 items in this collection, which are mostly brief notes on the occasion of Robert sending checks to Sarah in California. There are other items as well, including some family photos, mostly of Robert with his granddaughter Miranda, as well as a copy of his death certificate. My favorite piece is simply some photograph pages stapled together, a reminiscence of her dad, Sarah wrote for a Father's Day event at the Unitarian Universalist Church of Berkeley on June 21st, 1998. Sarah's reminiscences recounts Robert teaching her not to be prejudiced toward people from the other side of Mount John and Bolinas. She writes, I came of age in Bolinas, a small town where folks kept taking down the sign that pointed the way to get there. People around me often communicated the viewpoint that we, who live in Bolinas, were better than the over-the-hillers, which referred to anyone who came from the other side of Mount John. When I was a teenager, a man came up to my dad and said, hey, Bob, how you doing? When he walked away, I remarked, what a turkey. My dad said, Sarah, I don't like to hear you talk like that. We are all turkeys. That moment spoke to my heart and stands out in my memory. Sarah also recounts how her dad sat in on her women's studies course when she had cracked her pelvis so that she would not lose her place in the class. She writes, "He was very impressed with my women's studies teacher, who asked him, one, did I know he was there? And two, did he have my permission to be there?" So lastly, I want to turn to Creeley's library proper. And while cataloging his books and archiving the inserts, I found what is, as far as I can tell, an unpublished and until now unknown poem by Creeley that I would like to share. It is a short poem on the back of a US Airways boarding pass for a flight from Buffalo to Newark, placed inside Philip LaPate's personal essays, Against Joy de Vivre. On the title page of his book, LaPate, along with his inscription, provided his address and phone number in New York City. And with Penelope's help, I've been able to decipher most of Robert's handwriting, though we remain uncertain of one word, which maybe the rest of you can help with. The poem is entitled Smoke, and it reads, "At times think to age as quickly as possible. The days blurred with passage, all an investment of how long. Thus to intuit illness, the world, all time spent completely." Is the long word beginning line six investment? Endorsement. When I sent this poem to Penelope, she wrote back, "My guess is that Robert was traveling, wanting to smoke, wanting to stop smoking, frustrated, writing it down." There is an earlier different poem by Creeley entitled Smoke, which the collected poems has from being in the book in London. The first Smoke concerns flight more explicitly than the later one. It begins, "Again in space, elsewhere, displaced, as they say, an envoy to you, thinking of you, delaying direct thought, perhaps." And perhaps Creeley echoes this earlier flight, unwittingly or not, in the later poem, written most likely while flying to Newark. His books are full of such correspondences, and once we figure out that word, we'll have a new Creeley poem. Thanks.
Questions or comments? Or you can address one another.
Emma, I have just to tell you that that book in the Wordsworth, that flower in the Wordsworth poem, is a primrose, and Robert and I picked it in Wordsworth's garden in the Lakes District.
Wow.
So I'm glad you got it. And talking about Robert's filing system. You refer to his things in the book as a filing cabinet. Well, Robert hardly used a filing cabinet. It wasn't something that came to him. It wasn't given to use filing cabinet. But his filing system was associational. And so if he put things in books, he would know where to go to find them. It was completely that simple. But also, he had a desk in the, when we lived in Buffalo in an old firehouse, we had a big room, and he had a desk about this long, and each pile would be quite tall and have something on top of it, but it was all association stuff. When something was lost, because it was forgotten, because he had forgotten what the association was, it could have been with a number of things, and the way of finding it was desperate, exhausting, terrible. So thank you. Just thank you for the work that you've done. It's wonderful to see, and really very exciting to me to see these books being put to such terrific use. It really does feel like spring, you know, things coming up again, things surfacing and growing. I greatly appreciate it and all your work. Thank you.
Thank you.
We have one question, Steve.
Oh, Sandra.
Yes. I'm a late comer to the proceedings today, so in listening to these four interesting reflections on the archives, took me back to my days as a graduate student working as a researcher with James E.B. Breslin, who wrote the definitive biography of Mark Rothko. And it was tremendously interesting. I had first taken a seminar with him on biography and then was his research assistant, mostly transcribing interviews that he had done with Rothko's peers and friends. And so I've enjoyed this walk down memory lane thinking about that whole process. But I wanted to ask the panelists about your own reflections along these lines. And, if your time in the archive has you thinking about a dream list of people you would like to interview if you were to write the Creeley biography, or if there are things about biography that stand out to you having spent this time doing this work.
I could say maybe a brief biographical anecdote. My first encounters with Creeley were in the Olson Archive, which is popular. My first encounters with Creeley were in the Olson Archive at the University of Connecticut, which is populated very much with Creeley's letters to Charles Olson. And so eventually I became invested in Olson in particular, and he became sort of focal point of my research, and it was only years later that I came back to the Black Mountain figures. But engaging with Creeley in the second pass was something of a binary switch. Now I felt as if I was searching for Creeley by way of all of his relationships. Creeley is very absent from the archive, but all of his relationships are very present. And so you're constantly reading letters written by other people, postcards, pictures, ephemera written by others, produced by others, and sent by others. But Creeley is absent, and so trying to tease him out of the archive is a process of trying to find presence by way of absence, which was just a very interesting way to pursue biography.
There are a lot of really great pieces, but one thing that's striking about looking through all the books that you generally don't get reading a biography is a profound sense of the mundane. There are a lot of, for example, lots of young authors would send Creeley copies of their books saying, read this. And he obviously hasn't, but he's left the letter in the books. And
how do you know that he hasn't?
You can generally, I don't have absolute knowledge, but You can. There's some books feel unused.
That's right. But that was what Robert was like.
Yeah.
You could read it, but you would never know he'd been there.
So in biography, you make presumptions, and that can be dangerous.
I guess I could. I resonated with what you were saying because I worked first on the Creeley archives, and then this past summer I worked on the Ed Dorn archives. So I had a similar experience where I first learned Creeley in his archives, as I talked about, and then found his letters a year later to Ed Dorn when I was thinking about Ed Dorn. And I think that those relationships, seeing the different archives and seeing Creeley's letters that were sent to him, and then the way that he was writing letters to other people, that was instructive to me. So I suppose acquiring more archives would be one thing I would think about in terms of thinking of doing biographies for Creeley, is seeing how, or visiting different archives, seeing how he shows up differently in different poets' collections of books and letters. And, yeah.
Part of what's interesting is that people have a very different perception of themselves than other people do. So it's almost like you can read letters by Creeley or by Dorn, but you get a of the person based on who they were interacting. you know, we're slightly different depending on who we're talking to. And so this kind of second person ascription or the person kind of living in the memory of others and how others remember the poet or how others see the poet seems to be sort of interesting. I'm interested in cognitive approaches to literature, so this is really interesting to think about it from that perspective. And the other thing would be is that the person's the sense of this being a real person and not somebody that you put up on a pedestal, but you really get the sense of a person. What do they care about? How do they treat other people? And that really comes out in the archives. I didn't read a lot of letters from Creeley, but he seems like such a kind man, so generous towards other people. Like was with Dorn. You really get a sense of their willingness and their desire to help others, and that somehow these kinds of friendships and goodwill are really big part of what these poets were about. You know, the sense that they're good people. And that is something that you sometimes don't get necessarily from reading someone's poems. Poems can sometimes be performative and they perform different functions, but do you really get a sense of the person from what other people say or write about them? So.
Maybe ask Emma. I was really curious about that we're looking at all the inscriptions. Did she, you're looking at, sounded like you said, if I got the numbers right, you must have been looking at hundreds of inscriptions. Mm-hmm. Are you seeing, what kind of patterns do you see when you look at the big numbers of inscriptions? What do people do to this?
That's a good question, and you might speak to this too. I mean, certainly the majority, I would say, were notes of thanks for the influence that Creeley had had. And then sort of writing in a style, either a poem or sort of incorporating the language of Creeley's poetry somehow. That would have been another big pattern that I noticed.
Does anybody like play with the form?
Sure. There was definitely there was a lot of there were some sort of visual art, some cartoon characters drawn in margins, and some paintings done. So I suppose another one is that you can tell the character of the author sending the book by the inscription that they were doing. There's a lot of continuity between their thing, the form of the thanks to Creeley, and the way that the book is working as well. Do you have anything to add? I have a list here of a few more examples if you're interested to look through them afterwards.
Yeah, I'd love to do that.
Okay, yeah. So I'll keep thinking about it.
Another way to understand Creeley's relationship with other writers is to look at the blurbs he wrote on the backs of books. I think Creeley wrote more blurbs than anyone has ever read. He's on the back of every book. And that sense of relationship is really powerfully present as you start to notice that he's there. He's having his say on everyone's book in a most incredibly generous way. They're always very positive.
Tom Clark told him to stop doing that. This is getting ridiculous. Shut up.
But he couldn't stop himself.
Yeah, I think Kyle Schlesinger might have put out a chapbook of all of Creeley's sign-offs from his letters. All the different ones. Is that right?
It is, but it's with one. Is
one
it with Bergen Leighton, maybe?
Maybe that's what it is, yeah.
Where they, and it's just how they each sign off.
Yeah. My favorite one from our project is Off to Kill a Chicken, ho ho.
Well, that's a great note on draw our symposium to a close and to invite you to talk some more at a reception right outside. So thanks so much for coming.